Welcome back to Switch to Linux. Well, today we want to have a brief look at LibreWolf. This is a new fork of Firefox that is coming on down the pipeline. Of course, there's Firefox and we have Waterfox, and Waterfox recently sold to System One, which has probably the scariest privacy policy I've ever read in my life. I mean, these guys got nothing. Like, Microsoft, Google, child's play compared to System One's privacy policy. That's who bought Waterfox. Now, I do still have an older version of Waterfox I'm using, although I'm probably looking at dropping it sometime soon. And LibreWolf seems like a decent place to go. And so it does have the downsides like Waterfox had, where it's not particularly easy to install. It's not particularly findable on a variety of distributions. But what we want to do is we want to look at it. We want to play around with it. And I want to show you how you can, a couple of different ways you can go ahead and get it installed. Now, you can head on over to their GitLab page, gitlab.com/LibreWolf-community. They do actually have, you can see the browser over here. They have Gentoo builds already. We have a Mac build. There's common files. Windows is coming soon, but not here yet. I'm wondering if there's anything there. It's been updated 2 days ago. It looks like it's still kind of in progress. We have Arch, so if you have an Arch build of it, here is a build for it for Arch already. Let me double check what's in this guy here. All right, that's a patch, and there's some build and package information in there. And then we have the general Linux, which contains app images, flat packs, deb files, deb patches, a variety of different things. Now, as of right now, when I tested this, it does not build on Linux Mint 20. He does actually have a note up here. Following instructions are currently outdated, he says. The build scripts are currently meant to be run in a CI environment with Docker containers and GitLab runners. So instructions need to yet be written. And so, building it did not work for me when I tried it out, but all hope is not lost. They do have app images and flat packs, and here's Arch, here is AMD64, and so you can see there's a variety of different options. You can go back and grab older versions. We're going to go ahead and work with the latest version, 81.0.2-1, and I'm going to go ahead and show you a little bit about this. So for my development environment, I went ahead and installed a Linux Mint 20 build over here, and the things that I did at start is I went ahead and downloaded the Flatpak version here. I did download that whole folder, which I put right here in my home folder. Inside of here, let's see if we have the app image in here or not. I don't think we do. We do not. All right, so let's go ahead and come on back up here, and we'll get the files open back up. Let's go ahead, restore previous session. Let's close that, and head into your releases. Easiest way to get this guy running, guys, is going to be running an app image. Now, make sure that if you're on a basic computer, x86_64 is what you need. This guy here is not the one you're going to need. So we have the Flatpak. This is the one I've downloaded. We're going to get into why I downloaded this in a moment. But first, we're just going to go ahead and start with the app image, which is certainly the easiest way to get this guy running. This is not going to be found in your FlatHub repositories at the time I'm doing this video. And so it is a little bit more of a different setup. So it has downloaded. So let's go ahead and we'll boot up a new folder, go into our downloads, and here is our app image. All right, so remember, if you are running an app image for the first time, you just need to right-click it, Properties, go under Permissions, and allow executing it as a program. The other thing you can do if you want is you can go ahead and click this icon button over here, and you can add your own custom icon. So because I have actually downloaded the LibreWolf folder, I can actually go in here and just grab the icon for LibreWolf. And now my app image is matched as LibreWolf. Double click on it, and that should open you up into a browser. So here you have it. Here is LibreWolf. That's how easy it is, and that's actually why app images are a good platform. I can actually drop this somewhere. I can go ahead and create a shortcut to it, and we will show you how to do that in a moment. But let's go ahead and have a look at what we got. Let's go ahead and search for something. Looks like it is using DuckDuckGo as the default search engine. You see that we have uBlock Origin installed and configured by default. Now, basically, this is going to be Firefox, but there are a lot of changes. So if we go into About Config and hit Show All, you can see that as we scroll down, you'll see that there's some things here in bold. These are the things that they have basically taken Firefox and they had made a lot of these changes. Literally all those types of things that you might want for security and privacy have been changed. Let's go ahead and have a look at geo. Let's see if geolocation's there or not. So we do have some geolocation stuff. You'll see that some of these guys, geo-enabled, that's false. These are locked closed, okay? So I think he's doing this utilizing policies. I want to do a separate video about policies, which will lock certain configurations. I'm pretty sure that's how he's doing this. But you can see all those things that I walk through on my Firefox hardening guide, not only are they already set, but they already don't, have the ability to even turn them back on, which is good. The other one that drives me crazy is notifications. Let's see if I can spell notifications. Let's see what this says here. So it looks like notifications is still allowed. Browser notification bar. Onboard notification, true. I don't know, maybe not. DOM notifications enabled, true. So yes, notifications do still work in this browser. I like turning that off, but that is actually still there. Having a look at our preferences and such. So you can see restoring setups. You can see in this, nothing really different there. Your network settings, it does not have DNS over HTTPS by default enabled. It is set to use system proxy settings and proxy DNS set up. There shouldn't be any issues with that. Firefox usually does a no proxy. Here is your basic default. It just goes, it says Firefox Home, but every time I launch it, it's just an empty blank page. And then you can see that recommended by provider, highlights, a lot of this new crap that Firefox is trying to cram in is all disabled by default, which is awesome because I don't want that crap either. Search suggestions, you can see provide search suggestions is disabled by default and does not have the ability to re-enable it. And so it's not going to, remember that this one sends data back. So good to have that guy disabled by default. You can see what search engines are enabled here out of the box. You see we don't have Bing, we don't have Yahoo, we don't have Google. We have a few other ones. DuckDuckGo is the default. We have a DuckDuckGo Lite, CRX, Start Page. I don't know why Wikipedia is ever in there, but it is. There's Quant, Metagear, and Invidious. Never heard of Invidious, but there it is. Privacy and security. You can see all that's disabled. So you're pretty much stuck with custom. Choose what you want to do, I guess, right? So it says cookies. So you can adjust these because there's things that you do want to do with those. And then always set do not track, no ability to change it. Logins and passwords, you have the ability to enable those, but they're disabled by default. The basic default clears all history when it closes. And actually the desktop application in the bin files actually gives you, it actually always opens it into a private window, although that's something you can set or not set. You can see here, collection and use of data, it locks those and turns them all off. So overall, we basically get a pre-hardened Firefox. That's what we have inside of LibreFox. So this might be one that I poke around with, and maybe I start adding this onto my systems and experimenting with it. So this virtual machine here was just a testing ground. So let's go ahead and do a couple brief tutorials in here. First, suppose you want to use the app image and get this as a menu icon. What are we going to do? So first thing we want to do is, guys like Chris Ware, I believe, who uses app images primarily, what he actually does is he just has a folder created for app images. So let's go ahead and do that. Let's just create a folder called app images, and this is inside of our home directory. I'm going to move my app image over there. Now we're going to right click on the desktop, and I want to create a new launcher here. You want to give it a name. We're going to call this guy LibreWolf. And just for the purpose that we're going to do a couple of tutorials here, I'm just going to call this AI for app image command. We're going to go into our home folder, app images, and boot this guy up. And then change your icon. And again, since I've downloaded the, since I have went ahead and downloaded the LibreWolf folder here, oh, I gotta go into home though to find it. I can go here into app image and easily grab the icon from right here. All right, so that's all we need to do. It's gonna ask you, would you like to create a menu item? It will be placed in the other category. We're going to say yes. So now this is a desktop shortcut. All right, so now what we're going to do is you can see that we now have other, but we don't want that in other, we want that in internet. So here on Cinnamon, this is gonna differ depending on what system you're using. This will be applied to Cinnamon, which I think is what most people might be using, well, many people might be using. Under other here, we need to go into, open the editors. We need to go down here to other and see LibreWolf down here. We're gonna cut it, go into internet, and we're gonna paste it. All right, so that should be in there. So let's go ahead and close that, verify it's in there. Sometimes you might need to restart Cinnamon. In this case, it is fine. Right click it, add to panel. There, now we have a LibreWolf in the panel and in the menu under our app image, or under our internet there. So now you can boot up LibreWolf with the app image. Now, if there were an update to it, the advantage of app images is you can keep old versions. So you can just go ahead and remap your shortcut to the new version, or you can just take this guy. What you might ideally do is just rename this guy. Just LibreWolf.appImage, and then keep a default of whatever current version is in here and just don't map to it. And then when this one's old and you want to add a new one, then all you would need to do is just save the old one as an older version, take the new one and rename it to whatever the same file number is. And the system's going to load the same way. So that's how you can update it, and then you can roll it back just as easily. Very good system and setup on using your app image. So there's your app image. We have it now set up in the menus and everywhere else. So let's go ahead and unpin it from the panel. Let's go ahead and delete that. And we're going to show you how to run with our, we'll go ahead and run, I'll just keep that one there for now. I'll go ahead and show you the Flatpak. Now for this one here, there is not a specific repository. I could not get any automatic online repositories to work. So to install a Flatpak without a repository, you just need to grab a copy of the Flatpak. So that's what we have right here. This is the same thing that it was from the distribution. It's this file, this file right here. It's the x86_64 Flatpak. You'll notice that I have the file name correct. So we're going to download that, and that's within our home folder. And then what we're going to do is we can navigate to wherever that folder is in a terminal and run Flatpak install. And now in this case here, it's going to possibly ask us to install some other applications. So let's just go ahead and let's do an ls to show you that the file is right here in the terminal. So we're going to go ahead and paste it in here, hit enter, and then it's going to start the install process. First thing is, now in this case here, it looks like I already installed some of the other things. The first time I installed this, it wanted to download a few other things. I just hit yes on those. It will ask you for your password. Just go ahead and do that. It looks like it failed to install because I already have the Flatpak of this version installed. Now, I did have some issues in here where it was not showing up in the menu at all. And so we're going to create the same process that we did for the launcher, only it's going to be a little bit harder because now we have to dig deep into the system and figure out where this guy is at, which I believe should be under var, lib, Flatpak. And then we just need to keep digging and digging. Now, the current will go into there. Here. I think it's down here somewhere. It might be further. I think it's this one here. So I believe that's where it is. So now we're going to create our shortcut again, create new launchers here. This is from the Flatpak this time. Let's call this one, I almost call it LibreOffice, LibreWolf. And then we're going to go into our command. And now we just need to dig. Pull this guy up. So remember, we're just digging deep here. Digging deep, guys. Digging deep. Gets under files, share, LibreWolf. And I believe, if I'm correct, is this one. If I'm not correct, then I'll have to figure out which one it is and come back and recut the video. Haha. Where'd that guy go? I think it's called launch, right? There it is. All right. Once again, change the icon. Now we can dig all the way back into that folder, or since I already have it in my home directory, I'm just going to go ahead and just grab the app image one again because it works. All right, hit OK, hit a menu button, and that should show up under other. Now you'll notice here's where I had problems with the Flatpak where it did not want to show up. But if we go under menu, we should actually see it. The Flatpaks, oftentimes you do need to reboot the system to get them to show up. So it looks like that one's not showing up where it should be showing up. No, there it is. Actually, it showed up under internet this time. That might be because I was tweaking the system and I already told it where to go. So let's see if it's under internet. There it is. So hopefully that guy launches, and there we have it. Now that that is launched, that one is now the Flatpak version. This is the app image version. Again, I can left click. Yeah, that is right click. Wow. Add it to the panel. So now I have it added to the panel as well. So there you have it. There is how to play around with it. Overall, I'm not going to do a full comprehensive look at it because it's Firefox with a lot of those hardening things already set up. Very good job on that. This might be one that we start looking at and playing with a little bit more. And after I do that and play around with it a little bit, then I'll come back and tell you what I think, because the direction Waterfox took is kind of scaring me a little bit. So this one might be the replacement for a little while. So anyway, there is LibreWolf, a pre-hardened Firefox build. Let me know if you have played around with it, and if you need help figuring out with other systems, maybe I can do some videos about getting it on other systems if these don't work. I'm going to recommend if your system runs app images, use the app image version. I think it's going to give you the best overall experience on that. And so that's why app images are an excellent format to go with. So anyway, there we have it. Thanks for watching, guys. And I hope that you enjoy switching to Linux. Thank you for watching this video from Switched to Linux. This channel would not be possible without the backing of the program supporters scrolling on the screen now. You can be a supporter at Patreon at patreon.com/TOMM or at thinklifemedia.com. I also want to thank the open source community who creates such excellent software that makes producing this show possible. Please remember to support your software communities. Thank you, and I hope that you enjoy switching to Linux.